You know, Tom, you must be the thinnest-skinned guy in America, because you think that's a confrontational tone. Then, you should really see me when I'm pissed. That's not confrontational, all right? So, I love when people say they don't want to have argument. That's what we were sent here for. They believe in certain things. They believe in bigger government, higher taxes, and more spending. Here it is. Bigger government, higher taxes, more spending. I believe in less government, lower taxes, and in empowering local officials who are elected by their citizens to be able to fix their problems. That may lead to a disagreement or two. Now, I could say it really nicely. I could say it in the way that you all might be more comfortable with. You know, maybe we could go back to the last administration where I could say it in a way you wouldn't even understand it. Okay? But the fact of the matter is, this is who I am, and this is who the people elected.
You're a real big shot. You're a real big shot. Shut your mouth off. Keep walking.
People, with your rhetoric about how we are bilking this state of all this money, when I'm a taxpayer and because of the budget cuts that you have implemented, I am going to have a hard time paying my bills this year.
Well, a few things. First of all, I have not lambasted the public school system in the state of New Jersey. What I have lambasted, well, listen, let's start with this. I stood here and very respectfully listened to you. If what you want to do is put on a show and giggle every time I talk, well, then I have no interest in answering your question.
Governor, on Monday, are you going to be addressing the legislature?
Did I say on topic? Are you stupid? On topic. Next question. Good. Thank you. Thank you all very much, and I'm sorry for the idiot over there.
So we'll see. Now listen, everybody. Good. And there's been 23 months since then when all you've been doing is flapping your mouth and not doing anything. So listen, you want to have the conversation later? I'm happy to have it, buddy. But until that time, sit down and shut up.
And let me tell you something. After you graduate from law school, you conduct yourself like that in a courtroom, your rear end's going to get thrown in jail, idiot.
It's the right time for us to set an example for Washington, D.C. on the right way to do these things in a bipartisan way. And that's exactly what we're doing here.
Governor, I'm sure not the only one in this room has a off-topic question.
No, I won't permit you to. I told you that there's going to be only on-topic questions today, so permission denied. Yes, sir.
I was going to ask how your administration forward the issue of NJ Transit and concerns of the possibility of a strike.
That's an off-topic question. I think you understand that I'm answering on-topic questions today, not off-topic questions, because I don't want to. Anything else? Anything else on topic? Anything else on topic?
Considering that we're getting back to normal.
Anything else on topic?
Do we expect a time frame that we'll be able to
ask? Anything else on topic? Charlie?
Just on the timing of the announcement today, was this done today to distract attention from the firestorm of the Donald Trump endorsement?
Well, of course, because I do something as serious as a Supreme Court nomination in 24 hours. I've interviewed prospective candidates, I've talked with them about their willingness to serve, and I've done all that in the last 24 hours, Charlie. No, this has been in preparation for quite some time. And today is the day that I decided to do it.
On the follow on that issue is, what about the criticism about your endorsement that...
That's off topic, Charlie. Thank you.
Eligible uninsured here in New Jersey. We have been working day and night to get them connected to coverage. What we have gotten on the part of the administration, despite every gesture we have made to try to engage your administration, is silence. We are talking to consumers on a daily basis who have gone to those public sector workers that you disparage here today from the CWA. They're on the front lines trying to enroll people in the Medicaid expansion, which you adopted, which we applaud. But you
That's not silence then, I guess, right?
No.
That's not part of the silence you've been met with when I expanded the Medicaid program.
Let me ask you this.
When I expanded the Medicaid program, is that silence?
No, but what is silence is you have taken what the feds have given and not put up the state resources to match.
Well, that's simply not true. I didn't accept the federal resources.
I wanted the savings that the Medicaid program is realizing from the cost shifting of federal dollars needs to remain in the Medicaid program and needs to do a number of things.
You're simply wrong.
Increasing staffing. No,
yeah, no, you're wrong. The Medicaid program has been expanded. We're spending more dollars today, both federal and state, on Medicaid than we did at the beginning of my administration. So you're simply wrong, and to stand up here and to misinform people because you have an agenda is just simply incorrect.
We have a budget statement. We will be happy to share it with you. And listen, we have asked for a meeting.
I write the budget, so I don't need to read your budget statement. I write the budget. And Medicaid has been expanded in this state. And I'm sorry that you favor Obamacare and I do not.
I'm sorry.
It's just the way it goes.
There is not anywhere on the application that asks what your party affiliation is. We work with people, 900,000 people. It does not ask
I don't care what your party affiliation
you
is.
To.
And I didn't bring up party affiliation, did you?
To be insured.
You brought
no
up party
one,
affiliation. I did not.
No one benefits. Who benefits from the fact
everybody
that
you is benefiting
are
who needs Medicaid
in the way of connecting people to coverage?
We're not standing in the way of connecting people
you
to coverage. And New Jersey Family Care is one of the most advertised and aggressive programs. Yeah. Okay, so let's break it down then. We've expanded Medicaid. We're the second most generous Medicaid program in the United States of America. We've
that's
expanded
true.
It. Yes. Okay.
But
so,
the
so this is the silence
people
and
need
the
to connect, and that's almost 400,000 of them
who qualify for subsidy. You believe that Obamacare works, and I believe it does not. And I'm not going to invest further money in a failed federal program.
We need no one benefits. To have uninsured people, not our economy, not the individuals, not our hospital systems, not our insurers. The insurers, the hospital assistants, the hospital programs, advocates, even your own Medicaid director are all together in knowing we must connect people to coverage.
We're asking you to join that and help to increase the 2 weeks ago, I met with my Medicaid director, and she had no complaints. So I think that my access to my Medicaid director is significantly better than your opinion of it. I don't know how many times you can stand up there and give a speech and be wrong and continue to keep the microphone in your hand. Somebody like you who doesn't know a damn thing about what you're talking about except to stand up and show off when the cameras are here. I've been here when the cameras aren't here, buddy, and done the work.
Listen, let me just,
I'm glad you do. Either sit down and keep quiet or get out, one or the other. We're done with you. Go ahead.
What I recently found out about was the Abbott School Districts.
My name is Henry from Cherry Hill.
This is a coordinated partisan effort that they announced in the newspaper. Although when they announced it in the newspaper, they said they were going to be polite and raise their hands and wait to be called on and all the rest of that. I don't know who these folks are, but in the end, understand something. This is the kind of thing, that activity is the kind of thing that causes the problem you're talking about. Because when people just stand up and yell and scream and divide, then it shuts down debate.
They work because you get the opportunity to ask whatever the heck it is you want to ask me. That guy's yelling and screaming at me in the back and getting all, oh, let me answer my question, gets me all hot. Now it's going to be like on the YouTube somewhere, me calling him an idiot, you know.
I said, you know, I don't get it. Why are you booing the first guy to tell you the truth? You think I want to come in this room and give anything but good news? I'm in politics. I'd love to give nothing but good news. But I can't. I simply can't.
And you haven't really shared a public opinion of how Lakewood's other schools could be fixed.
Yeah, I've read your inflammatory editorials in your paper. Listen, fact of the matter is, they wanted me to visit the public schools when the public schools aren't open. That makes sense. I'll go walk around an empty school.
84 days I work here in Rutherford. You know what that equals? $83,000 a day. And I'm begging you to pay me $83,000. Really? It's $11,000.
If you include the cost of your benefits, if you include the cost of your pension, and you include your paid holidays.
I'm still $14,000 less. I'm still 14, and you're not compensating me for my education, and you're not compensating me for my experience.
You know what? Then you don't have to do it. Then in times of economic crisis, this whole argument is over the fact that I asked people to not take a raise for a year and to pay 1.5% of their salary towards their benefits. And your union has said that is the greatest assault on public education in the history of this. That's why the union has no credibility. Stupid statements like that.
And I thought, I tried to be patient with the guy. Every time I tried to answer, he started yelling over me again or anything. I'm like, oh, damn, man, I'm governor. Could you just shut up for a second?
You don't send your children to public schools. You send them to private schools. So I was wondering why you think it's fair to be cutting school funding to public schools.
What's her name? What's her name, guys? Real quick, because the governor's talking. What is it? Gail. Talk to Gail.
Hey, Gail, you know what? First off, it's none of your business. I don't ask you where you send your kids to school. Don't bother me about where I send mine. Secondly, I pay $38,000 a year in property taxes for a public school system, predominantly in Mendham, that my wife and I don't choose to utilize because we've decided as parents that we believe a religious education should be part of our children's everyday education. So we send our children to parochial school. Third, I, as governor, am responsible for every child in this state.
I find it fascinating that a doctor in Arizona who's never met me, never examined me, never reviewed my medical history or records, knows nothing about my family history, could make a diagnosis from 2,400 miles away. She must be a genius. She should probably be the Surgeon General of the United States, I suspect, because she must be a genius. I think this is just another hack who wants 5 minutes on TV. And it's completely irresponsible. My children saw that last night. And she sat there on TV and said, I'm afraid he's going to die in office. I have four children between 9 and 19. My 12-year-old son came to me last night and said, Dad, are you going to die? I mean, come on. This is irresponsible stuff. And people who have a medical license, who have the privilege of having a medical license, should, in my view, conduct themselves more responsibly than that. If she wants to get on a plane and come here to New Jersey and ask me if she wants to examine me and review my medical history, I'll have a conversation with her about that. Until that time, she should shut up.
And there should be some regulation. I have no clue whether the federal government's the proper place. My instinct is to say hell no, just about everything about the federal government.
Are we really talking about getting the government involved? In fantasy football? We have $19 trillion in debt. We have people out of work. We have ISIS and Al-Qaeda attacking us. And we're talking about fantasy football? Can we stop? How about this? How about we get the government to do what they're supposed to be doing? Secure our borders, protect our people, and support American values and American families. Enough on fantasy football. Let people play. Who cares? What we don't do is do what Hillary Clinton and John Kerry and Barack Obama want us to do, which is their solution for everything. Put more taxes on it, give more money to Washington, D.C., and then they'll fix it. Well, there's no evidence that they can fix anything in Washington, D.C.
What should we do?
What we should do is to be investing in all types of energy, John. All types of energy. And I've laid out...
Being government?
No, John. John, do you want me to answer? You want to answer. because I got to tell you the truth. Even in New Jersey, what you're doing is called rude. So...
We've laid out a national energy plan that says that we should invest in all types of energy. I'll tell you, you could win a bet at a bar tonight, since we're talking about fantasy football, if you ask who the top three states in America are that produce solar energy. California and Arizona are easy, but number three is New Jersey. Why? Because we worked with the private sector to make solar energy affordable and available to businesses and individuals in our state. We need to make sure that we do everything we can across all kinds of energy, natural gas, oil, absolutely, but also where it's affordable, solar, wind in Iowa has become very affordable and it makes sense. That's the way we deal with global warming, climate change, or any of those problems, not through government intervention, not through government taxes, and for God's sake, don't send Washington another dime until they stop wasting the money they're already sending there.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.
There is money you could find to fund a pension.
Where?
You wrote the law in 2011. You wrote the law.
Yeah.
And based upon the law, you bragged about the law.
I still brag about the law. It's a good law.
And now you say it's unconstitutional.
Because we don't have the money to pay it. Now, we passed that law, not just me, by the way. The legislature passed the law, too.
Yes.
And we passed it based upon the projections of revenue that were given to us at the time, not only by the state treasurer, but by the Office of Legislative Services. They both said that based upon the projections that they had of revenue increases, that we would be able to afford to make the payments. The revenue didn't come in. So you cannot pay what you do not have. You simply can't do it. And it doesn't get to the core problem, though. The core problem is this stuff is too expensive. Believe me, I'd rather not have this argument. If I had the money, I'd pay it. And the proof of that is that I paid more money into this pension system than any governor in history. Anybody. And in fact, more than the last five combined by $800 million. So what makes me laugh about this, quite frankly, is that you have people out there yelling and screaming. Where were they? Where were they when Jim Florio wasn't paying into the pension? Where were they?
Right. What happened
Where were they when Christy Whitman was not paying into the pension? Where were they when Jim McGreevy was not paying into the pension and Dick Cody was not paying into the pension? No, they weren't. They didn't even sue them back then.
And let's dispel once and for all with this fiction that Barack Obama doesn't know what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. Barack Obama is undertaking a systematic effort to change this country, to make America more like the rest of the world. That's why he passed Obamacare and the stimulus and Dodd-Frank and a deal with Iran. It is a systematic effort to change America. When I'm president of the United States, we are going to re-embrace all the things that made America the greatest nation in the world, and we are going to leave our children what they deserve, the single greatest nation in the history of the world.
Senator Rubio, thank you. I do want to ask Governor Christie. Governor Christie, you said, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me, when it comes to electing a first-term senator. You heard Senator Rubio make the case that he does have the experience. Your response?
Sure. First, let's remember something. Every morning when a United States senator wakes up, they think about what kind of speech can I give or what kind of bill can I drop. Every morning when I wake up, I think about what kind of problem do I need to solve for the people who actually elected me. It's a different experience. It's a much different experience. And the fact is, Marco, you shouldn't compare yourself to Joe Biden. And you shouldn't say that that's what we're doing. Here's exactly what we're doing. You have not been involved in a consequential decision where you had to be held accountable. You just simply haven't. And the fact is, when you talk about Hezbollah Sanctions Act that you list as one of your accomplishments and just did, you weren't even there to vote for it. That's not leadership, that's truancy. The fact is that what we need to do, what we need to have in this country is not to make the same mistake we made 8 years ago. Fact is, it does matter when you have to make decisions and be held accountable for them. It does matter when the challenges don't come on a list of a piece of paper of what to vote yes or no every day, but when the problems come in from the people that you serve. I like Marco Rubio, and he's a smart person and a good guy, but he simply does not have the experience to be president of the United States and make these decisions. We've watched it happen, everybody, for the last 7 years. The people of New Hampshire are smart. Do not make the same mistake again.
If I may respond, I would mention Senator Rubio. Well, I think the experience is not just what you did, but how it worked out. Under Chris Christie's governorship of New Jersey, they've been downgraded 9 times in their credit rating. This country already has a debt problem. We don't need to add to it by electing someone who has experience at running up and destroying the credit rating of a state. But I would add this. Let's dispel with this fiction that Barack Obama doesn't know what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. He is trying to change this country. He wants America to become more like the rest of the world. We don't want to be like the rest of the world. We want to be the United States of America. And when I'm elected president, this will become once again the single greatest nation in the history of the world, not the disaster Barack Obama has imposed upon us.
Senator Rubio, thank you. I do want to bring in Governor Bush on this.
Hold on,
because
one
you've
second.
Made this.
Excuse me.
If you'd like to respond to the economic.
I think he directly mentioned me in my record in there. So I think I get a chance to respond. You see, everybody, I want the people at home to think about this. That's what Washington, D.C. does. The drive-by shot at the beginning with incorrect and incomplete information, and then the memorized 25-second speech that is exactly what his advisors gave him. See, Marco, the thing is this. When you're president of the United States, when you're a governor of a state, the memorized 30-second speech where you talk about how great America is at the end of it doesn't solve one problem for one person. They expect you to plow the snow. They expect you to get the schools open. And when the worst natural disaster in your state's history hits you, they expect you to rebuild their state, which is what I've done. None of that stuff happens on the floor of the United States Senate. It's a fine job. I'm glad you ran for it. But it does not prepare you for president of the United States.
Chris, your state got hit by a massive snowstorm 2 weeks ago. You didn't even want to go back. They had to shame you into going back. And then you stayed there for 36 hours, and then he left and came back to campaign.
See,
those are the facts. Here's the bottom line. This notion that Barack Obama doesn't know what he's doing is just not
there
true.
There it is.
He knows exactly what he's doing.
There it is, the memorized 25-second speech.
Well, that's the reason why this campaign is so important. Because I think this notion, I think this is an important point. We have to understand what we're going through here. We are not facing a president that doesn't know what he's doing. He knows what he is doing. That's why he's done the things he's done.
You know,
that's why we have a president that passed Obamacare and the stimulus. All this damage he's done to America is deliberate. This is a president that's trying to redefine this country. That's why this election is truly a referendum on our identity as a nation, as a people. Our future is at stake. This election is not about the past. It is about what kind of country this is going to be in the 21st century.
Now, Chris, why don't you mention my name so I can get into this.
You know what the shame is, Marco? The shame is that you would actually criticize somebody for showing up to work, plowing the streets, getting the trains run back on time, when you've never been responsible for
Chris,
that in your entire life.
Okay. He didn't want to go back.
And the fact is, I went back, it got done, and here's
something. You didn't want to go back.
I went back. Oh, so, wait a second. Is that one of the skills you get as a United States Senator, ESP also?
I'm as entertained as anyone by this personal back and forth about the history of Donald and Carly's career. For the 55-year-old construction worker out in that audience tonight who doesn't have a job, who can't fund his child's education, I got to tell you the truth. They could care less about your careers. They care about theirs. Let's start talking about that on this stage. And stop playing the games.
Governor
stop
Chris,
playing, John, I'm not done yet, John.
A track
sorry.
Record of
stop,
leadership
and
is
stop,
not a game.
And stop
it is
playing,
the issue
and
in
Carly,
this election.
Carly, listen. You can interrupt everybody else on this stage. You can't interrupt me. Okay? The fact is that we don't want to hear about your careers back and forth and volleying back and forth about who did well and who did poorly. You're both successful people. Congratulations. You know who's not successful? The middle class in this country who's getting plowed over by Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton. Let's start talking about those issues tonight and stop this childish back and forth between the two of you.
Ms. Fiorina, I want to give you...
And I... You can boo all you want.
Actual climate
Governor,
change.
Governor Haley, are you bought
the
paper?
Is down by 90%
hold on, hold on.
In the last century.
Listen.
I've had enough. I've had enough already tonight of a guy who sounds like ChatGPT standing up here. And the last person in one of these debates, Brett, who stood in the middle of the stage and said, "What's a skinny guy with an odd last name doing up here?" was Barack Obama, and I'm afraid we're dealing with the same type of amateur standing stage tonight.
Come over and give me a hug. Give me a hug just
same,
like you did to Obama.
The same type of amateur.
And you'll help elect me just like you did to Obama, too. Give me that
the same
hug,
type of amateur.
Hold on.
You all signed a pledge to support the eventual Republican nominee. If former President Trump is convicted in a court of law, would you still support him as your party's choice? Please raise your hand if you would.
Yeah!
Just hold on. So just to be clear, Governor Christie, you were kind of late to the game there, but
no,
you raised your hand.
No, I'm doing this. Look, look, I'm doing this.
And
not
I know
this.
You didn't.
Whoa.
No.
What's
and the no, look? Look. Here's the bottom line. Someone's got to stop normalizing this conduct. Okay. Now, and not you believe that the criminal charges are right or wrong. The conduct is beneath the office of President of the United States. And you know, this is the great thing about this country. Booing is allowed, but it doesn't change the truth. It doesn't change the truth.
Mr. Ramaswamy, you raised your hand supporting.
No. I'd like to get in and respond. Let's just speak the truth, okay? President Trump, I believe, was the best president of the 21st century. It's a fact. And Chris Christie, honest to God, your claim that Donald Trump is motivated by vengeance and grievance would be a lot more credible if your entire campaign were not based on vengeance and grievance against one man. And if people at home want to see a bunch of people blindly bashing Donald Trump without an iota of vision for this country, they could just change the channel to MSNBC right now. But I'm not running for president of MSNBC. I am running for president of the United States. We're skating on thin ice, and we cannot set a precedent where the party in power uses police force to indict its political opponents. It is wrong. We have to end the weaponization of justice in this country.
30 seconds, Governor DeSantis.
Let me tell you
something. No, I'm sorry. 30 seconds, Governor Christie.
You make me laugh because you sit here in an answer right
now.
You sit here in an answer.
Go ahead, Governor Christie.
Hold on, Governor Christie.
Hold on.
Well, so listen, the more time we spend doing this, the less time they can talk about issues you want to talk about. So let's just get through this section. Governor Christie.
You sit here talking about how you want to stand up for the rule of law.
Yes.
And law and order. And the fact is that it can't be selective. In your book, you had much different things to say about Donald Trump than you're saying here tonight.
That's not true.
No, it is very true.
That is not true.
It's very true. I read it,
because
and I know.
There's a difference between
bad behavior
and illegal behavior, Chris. And you, as a prosecutor, should know better.
Yeah, you know what? I know a lot
there's
better.
There's a difference between bad behavior.
And I know a lot better than you do. You've never done it like you've never done anything to try to advance the interests of this government except to put yourself forward as a candidate tonight. And here's the thing. We've stood up for law and order. I did it as U.S. attorney. I did it as governor. And I am not going to bow to anyone when we have a president of the United States who disrespects the Constitution. He said.
Martha,
it's important to say that the president said, Donald Trump said, it's okay to suspend the Constitution. Now, the oath you take is to preserve, protect, and defend, not suspend. I will always stand up for our Constitution, regardless of the political pressure.
A little out of this world, and this is for you, Governor Christie. Do you believe that the recent spike in UFO encounters...
I get the UFO question?
Yeah, you do.
Come on, man.
There you go. We've been hearing a lot of testimony in Congress, and people are taking this a lot more seriously. And we're hearing that, you know, there are things going on that people aren't aware of. So, if you were president, Governor Christie, would you level with the American people about what the government knows about these possible encounters?
Martha, and especially coming from a woman from New Jersey, I think it's horrible that just because I'm from New Jersey, you asked me about unidentified flying objects and Martians. We're different, but we're not that different. And I want to look in that camera right now and tell you, Donald, I know you're watching. You can't help yourself. I know you're watching, okay? And you're not here tonight. Not because of polls and not because of your indictments. You're not here tonight because you're afraid of being on the stage and defending your record. You're ducking these things. And let me tell you what's going to happen. You keep doing that, no one up here is going to call you Donald Trump anymore. We're going to call you Donald Duck.
A question for Governor Christie. Students in your state are getting high marks on their report cards. But minorities are not doing well with math and reading. Black and Hispanic students averaging 29 points lower than white students in New Jersey. Would you address minorities first?
You have to address all students. And look, in our state, Stuart, frankly, before I was governor, that gap was close to 50%. And what we did was institute more charter schools and more Renaissance schools and more public school choice in New Jersey with innovative solutions in cities like Camden, where now we took what was the worst school district in America during my time, and we have now increased that by nearly 40% in terms of their proficiency. It can be done when you give people choice. But let's tell the truth to everybody about what this is. This public school system is no longer run by the public. It is run by the teachers' unions in this country. Randy Weingarten and her crew are absolutely strangling. They are taking the worst of their members and defending them rather than advocating for our kids. And when you have the President of the United States sleeping with a member of the teachers' union, there is no chance that you could take the stranglehold away from the teachers' union every day. They have an advocate inside the White House every day for the worst of their teachers, not for our students to be the best they can be. A President of the United States has to take on the teachers' union. I did it in New Jersey. And I will do it as President of the United States. And the fact of the matter is, we need to say right now that the Chinese-Russian alliance is something we have to fight against, and we are not going to solve it by going over and cuddling up to Vladimir Putin. Look, Donald Trump said Vladimir Putin was brilliant and a great leader. This is the person who is murdering people in his own country, and now not having enough blood, he's now going to Ukraine to murder innocent civilians and kidnap 20,000 children. And let me tell you, if you think that's where it's going to stop, if we give him any of Ukraine, next will be Poland. Right. This is a guy who said, this is a guy in 1991 who said that was the darkest moment in world history when the Soviet Union fell. Listen, everybody, he wants to put the old band back together, and only America can stop it. Right. And when I'm president, we will.
Governor Christie.
Really?
Just that
I, I'm usually not somebody who gets missed, but okay, let's go.
What's happening? Okay, I got you. Listen, you endorsed Donald Trump in 2016 and 2020. You gave him an A for his first term. Since then, however, you've turned on him, calling him a liar, a loser, a con man, and someone who cannot win. You've even said that you got into this race just to stop President Trump. His approval rating with Republicans is currently at 81%. Yours is at 25. Your best state is New Hampshire, and even there, two-thirds of GOP voters say they would be angry and disappointed if you won. Respectfully, Governor, you have not stopped Mr. Trump, and voters may wonder how you could possibly become the nominee of a party that does not appear to like you very much.
Yeah. Well, look, Megan, it's often very difficult to be the only person on the stage who's telling the truth and the only person who is taking on what needs to be taken on. I look at my watch now. We're 17 minutes into this debate, and except for your little speech in the beginning, we've had these three acting as if the race is between the four of us. The fifth guy, who doesn't have the guts to show up and stand here, he's the one who, as you just put it, is way ahead in the polls. And yet, I've got these three guys who are all seemingly to compete with, you know, Voldemort. He who shall not be named. They don't want to talk about it. The fact is that when you go and you say the truth about somebody who is a dictator, a bully, who has taken shots at everybody, whether they've given him great service or not over time, who dares to disagree with him, then I understand why these three are timid to say anything about it. Maybe it's because they have future aspirations. Maybe those future aspirations are now, or maybe they're 4 years from now. But the fact of the matter is, the truth needs to be told. And for us to go 17 minutes without discussing the guy who has all those gaudy numbers you talked about is ridiculous. I'm in this race because the truth needs to be spoken. He is unfit. This is a guy who just said this past week that he wants to use the Department of Justice to go after his enemies when he gets in there. I mean, the fact of the matter is, he is unfit to be president, and there is no bigger issue in this race, Megan, than Donald Trump, and those numbers prove it.
Governor Christie.
Strong relationship when I'm the president of the United States.
But would you say Elizabeth,
Elizabeth, look. This is the problem with the first three debates. Ron gets asked a question, and he doesn't answer it. Your question was very specific. You said, would you send American troops as commander-in-chief? And he went on to this minute and 30-second hosanna about his knowledge of the military and what we need to do, and didn't answer your question. Look, when you're president of the United States, you're not going to have a choice whether to answer that question or not. Your generals, your Secretary of Defense, your Secretary of State, your National Security Advisor are going to present plans to you. They're going to look at you and say, do we go or don't we, Mr. President? And you can't give a 90-second speech about your military service, as laudable as it
is. So would you send American troops in to rescue those
hostages? Absolutely. He could get them out safely. You're damn right I'd send the American Army in there to get our people home and get them home now. And I'll answer that question directly.
Thank you, Governor Christie.
That they want to send our troops to actually fight for. Look at that. This is what I want people to understand. These people have, I mean, she has no idea what the hell the names of those provinces are, but she wants to send our sons and daughters and our troops and our military equipment to go fight it. So reject this myth that they've been selling you, that somebody had a cup of coffee stint at the UN and then makes $8 million after, has real foreign policy experience. It takes an outsider to see this through. Look at the blank expression. She doesn't know the names of the provinces that she wants to actually fight for. And there's her puppet masters right there, the donors. The donors right there that are playing her like the puppet masters.
Hold on. Let me just say something here. You know, his reasonable peace deal in Ukraine, he made it clear. Give them all the land they've already stolen, promise Putin you'll never put Ukraine in Russia, and then trust Putin not to have a relationship with China. Let me tell you something. That's no reasonable.
That's not my deal.
Yes, Chris. It's exactly what you said.
I'll describe my deal to you.
At every debate.
Don't interrupt me. I didn't interrupt you.
Okay?
You say this at every debate.
You go out on the stump and you say something. All of us see it on video. We confront you on the debate stage. You say you didn't say it, and then you back away. And I want to say
what? I'll tell you exactly what I said, Chris.
I'm not done yet.
Well, this is...
Now, look.
This is nonsense. This man is spewing. This man is spewing nonsense.
Let me tell you something. This is the fourth debate. The fourth debate that you would be voted in the first 20 minutes as the most obnoxious blowhard in America. So shut up for a little while.
I'm going to respond to that.
We're going to let you respond to that.
I want to say something else. We're now 25 minutes into this debate, and he has insulted Nikki Haley's basic intelligence, not her positions, her basic intelligence. She doesn't know regions. She wouldn't be able to find something on a map that his three-year-old could find. Look, if you want to disagree on issues, that's fine. And Nikki and I disagree on some issues. But I'll tell you this, I've known her for 12 years, which is longer than he's even started to vote in a Republican primary. And while we disagree about some issues and we disagree about who should be president of the United States, what we don't disagree on is this is a smart, accomplished woman, and you should stop insulting
her. So I'm going to take this several times over. Yeah. So first of all, I think we just learned something from Chris Christie. We learned three things right there. First of all, Chris Christie also doesn't know what provinces in eastern Ukraine he actually wants us to fight for. Chris, your version of foreign policy experience was closing a bridge from New Jersey to New York. Yeah. So do everybody a favor, just walk yourself off that stage, enjoy a nice meal, and get the hell out of this race. When it comes to Nikki, I think if you're going to actually send your sons and daughters to go die in somebody else's war, you better, excuse me, Chris, I'm speaking, and I'm not done yet.
You had your chance, and we're going to be done. Let me just say this. You know, this is the kind of thing where he talks about experience. You know, I was the U.S. attorney in New Jersey when the terrorist attacks were launched against the United States in 2001. I brought the first two cases in this country against terrorists who tried to attack us again. And I know about the threat of terrorism and bullying in this country and around the world. And at that time, he was learning about the provinces in Ukraine, sitting with his smart-ass mouth at Harvard. That's what was going on. And so,
The fact of the matter is, and back then he was a Democrat. So, you know, the fact is that all he knows how to do.
Well, you're busy hugging Barack Obama.
All he knows how to do is insult good people who have committed their lives to public service and not say anything that moves the ball down the field for the United States.
Now, Chris, you had your chance to wax eloquent on Donald Trump. You've been doing it all this whole race.
Why doesn't he just answer the question? The question was very direct. Is he fit to be president or isn't he? The rest of the speech is interesting, but completely non-responsive. And if we were in a courtroom, they'd strike the answer and say, Governor DeSantis.
No, they wouldn't. They would say that.
You're a smart man.
No, they would. No, they wouldn't.
They would strike the answer because you're not answering it.
Is he fit? You have your thing.
Is he fit or isn't he? No, I don't have my thing.
We don't.
He's the thing. Is he fit or isn't he? You're talking about him being 80 years old.
It doesn't mean that somebody couldn't get elected. That's not the people that are
elected. Governor DeSantis, let him finish.
Ron, is he fit or isn't he?
No, Governor DeSantis, let him finish.
Ron, is he fit?
I think we have an opportunity to do somebody who is in the prime minister.
Yes.
You don't have to worry about all this stuff with confidence. We can get it done.
Stop.
We'll do it.
I'm going to come to you. Finish.
Look, Father Time is undefeated. I don't know how he would score on a test, but I know this. We have an opportunity to nominate someone and elect someone for two terms who's going to be spitting nails on day one and for 8 years deliver
you
big result. We should not nominate somebody who's almost 80 years old.
Okay. He's afraid to answer.
No, I'm not.
You have to. No. Either you're afraid or you're not listening.
No, it's not.
There's a simple question.
Is he fit?
No one can hear this. No one can hear you.